What's up, Sarasota? On today's episode, we have got an incredibly talented guest. And while he may not be from Sarasota or even born in this country, if you spent any amount of time on the internet or St. Armands Circle, you've seen this guy. I was on St. Armands Circle one time, ran into this guy, was mind-blowing the talent that he has. He's a musical talent. He's an improv specialist. You may know him from his YouTube content or his Instagram content. Say what's up to our guest today, Dovydas.
My man, Dovydas. What's going on, buddy? Good to have you here. Oh, we're going right into arm wrestling.
Arm wrestling. One, two, three.
Round one, fight.
Oh. Go!
Oh, he's actually doing it. He's actually and he wins.
Wait! Disqualification. He grabbed into the table. I'm gonna miss my seat.
I had to watch out for that freaking ring because I was like, "Oh, dang, that looks like it could hurt."
Well, so. It looked like it would have some power in it. You should have activated it.
Like a power ring or what?
Well, listen, if you don't know this guy, you've probably been under a rock because he's got 1.5 million followers on or subscribers on YouTube.
Something like that.
Your freaking content is amazing. So for the three people watching this show, you know, go check this guy out on YouTube. But I first saw Dovydas, right? Saying that right?
Yeah, you did.
On St. Armands. You know, there's this guy, he's got a freaking piano or like a keyboard. He's got the drum things. He's got his guitar. He's got a harmonica. I think he had a feather in his cap as well. And he's playing like insane music. You're incredibly talented. So
thank you.
We wanted to have you on and, you know, kind of tell your story, your background, maybe go through some of the hard times they gave you out there on St. Armands as well, because I know that you you had some fun with that. But
oh, yeah.
Welcome to the show, man, and thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Yeah, this is really cool. Cool environment, yeah.
So what originally brought you to Sarasota?
I got a record deal at 19, and the record label was in Bradenton.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah.
Cool deal.
What so record label's in Bradenton?
It's like the type you don't want to get a deal with.
give him a shout out.
I love it.
Yeah, yeah. It was Howling Dog Studios. Yeah, it's like, should I burn them? No, it's fine. It's rude. I'm not going
to
do that.
You don't have to do that. That's fine.
we try to keep it positive on this podcast, you know, despite what we sometimes feel.
But you just, to put it politely, you just outgrew.
No, it's like, you know, it sounds cooler than it actually was, but there's always a lesson, you know? So there's a lot of lessons to be learned, you know, about, you know, what a record deal is and how the old school music business model tends to handle an artist and, you know, how long it actually takes and what are the resources and the infrastructure that goes into, like, artist development and, you know, all the different steps of actually trying to make it in a conventional manner in the music business, you know?
Yeah.
And that it actually doesn't work and it's dead.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
You didn't sell many albums.
Yeah, it's like, no, the whole even concept of like, we're going to record a CD, shoot a music video for one of the songs, put you on tour, book these shows, maybe get you open to somebody, maybe put you on the festival. It's like, that's not the way to make it.
Right.
That's what's like 30 years ago. And everyone's trying to repeat the model and it's like gone.
So alternatively, it feels like, you know, you're able to do your own marketing given the access to social media.
Yeah.
Is that your stance on it all?
Well, I mean, took trial and error. Like I've tried like everything conventionally. Again, like record deal, CD, album, singles, music video, going on tour, finding a booking agent, manager, promoter, you know, appearing on the morning, you know, talk show like ABC 7 or SNN 6 or something, you know, it's like, right. Okay, people, we're going to
promotion,
like, you know, and then nothing, like literally looking for a detour for like an opening in a football field, like a missing piece on the chessboard. It's like, that's where no one is going. And, you know, like unconventional route. Cause my sister said, oh, there's this YouTuber PewDiePie and he makes $10 million a year on YouTube. Like what? And she told me that in 2015, you know, so then I kind of like, oh, there's a whole new way. You know,
that was a light bulb for you.
Pretty much, yeah. Well, I didn't know the format, you know.
So is your sister your agent now?
Well, no. It was just that she was. We were watching.
She watched a lot of YouTube.
Yeah.
But you know, it's also you tried so many things that you eventually found what worked for you.
Exactly.
You know, so that's a great business lesson generally.
Yeah.
Right. You know, sometimes you gotta kiss a lot of frogs to get the prince. Right.
That's a lot of frogs. God damn it.
How many frogs have you kissed?
Define frog. I see one person.
Yeah, like 5 o'clock club on a Saturday night at 2 a.m.
5 o'clock, that's a throwback.
It doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, not confirming or denying that one.
It does not. So you moved here for a record label. When was that?
2012.
Okay. I have a question. When you moved here, this might be a dumb one. Did you speak English at the time?
I did, but not as good as I do now.
Yeah, you were fluent.
I was like, playing and so, oh, you were outstanding. I was like, no, I was standing inside. Yeah.
That's great. So that took me a second to even get that one, actually.
Yeah, let me get out something, too. Felipe walked in before you were here and before Brad was here, and he goes, oh, so, I assume you and Brad, referring Trey and Brad, are not musicians. And I'm like you fucking are? And,
and what does he play? Known
on this podcast, whatever the guest is, he has much experience in it.
I do not have much experience.
So Dovydas brought his guitar for Felipe.
There we go. That's why I wear this thing. Exactly. It gives me some credibility.
It's like, right? I immediately
we might have to listen to what he has to say. Because he said he plays the guitar. So we can test
him. No.
I tried to play the guitar, but these fingers, these sausage fingers, are not made for strings, right? They're made for maybe drumsticks, but not freaking guitar. I can promise you that.
Cool.
They didn't work.
Bass guitar.
So you play the guitar, obviously, yes. And I've seen you doing the one-man band thing with the multiple instruments.
Yeah.
How many instruments would you say you play?
Like 5 or 6.
Okay, the guitar?
So guitar, self-taught. Then I went to music school. I wanted to take guitar, but they didn't have any availability anymore because it was all the time slots taken by the other kids. But the drums were available, so I took drums. Mm. And when you take drums, it's a percussive rhythm instrument. The melodic instrument is mandatory, so they taught me like a xylophone marimba type of thing, so you play like a large piano thing, but with sticks, right? And then kind of like self-taught on piano, and then harmonica, and then what else? Guitar. Oh, bass guitar, too. Guitar, bass guitar, drums, piano, harmonica, xylophone, like kind of 6, and then
5.5, 7.
Yeah, whatever, who counts? I can fake like 2 melodies on an accordion,
Good deal.
So I've seen your videos, and they're awesome. You use that, what is it, a sequencer it's called?
So it's like a 5-track looper, essentially. A looper, I get to record, in real time. It has like faders. It's like a mini studio, and I can like record and then play it back immediately.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's so cool to watch that little process building the song. I think I just thought it was cool.
So I think your drumming background kind of made you more apt to excel using that kind of equipment, right? Because
absolutely. Because it's like if like any like family of string instruments, they're like all related. But then to understand the rhythm, and then to the components of the rhythm, kick, snare, hi-hat, and what each should be doing. That's why, like, other people that try to copy me, if they don't have training in drums, they kind of, like, end up, like, using, like, I don't know, like a sequencer or something, but that lacks variety or, like, control to, like, drop the hi-hat out or, like, like, do, like, an EDM beat drop, like, Sarasota,
so you're almost like a musician and a DJ up there,
pretty much. Yeah, like a manual DJ.
Make sure we clip that Sarasota thing. That could be our new intro. Dovydas is gonna record original music for our intro.
Okay,
it's perfect.
Perfect.
I love it. So I want to back. I want to get the kind of the full story for the audience. And you moved here because you had a record deal or a label deal or whatever.
Yeah.
That naturally didn't work out, so you stayed here. You said you were here for a decade, right?
Yeah.
So the transition, you kind of had that deal, didn't work out. That's when you immediately went into the YouTube stuff, or like, tell us about the process. How'd that happen?
Yeah, it took like almost 2 years to record a CD that should have taken like 3 months, and then so I guess the first year was the project, like, oh my God, I called my mom and dad on Skype, it's like, look, I have a record deal, it's like, I got signed to a record label, and it's like.
From where, by the way? You were from
originally? Lithuania.
So you moved from Lithuania to Bradenton or Sarasota?
Sarasota, okay. Yeah, so that good was move. Already like, big change. And the culture is different too. Any of you been to Europe?
No, not Lithuania.
Not Lithuania.
Okay.
A little bit of Europe.
A little bit of Europe. Okay.
Where specifically, Felipe?
UK mostly.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, which is obviously very different.
Yeah.
I have a good friend who was in Luxembourg for a while. He did like an exchange program.
Uh huh.
And he used to tell me all the stories about.
Would you consider him a frog or a prince?
I think that one's played out, Trey. Let's move on from the frogs.
Anyways.
You're the one in the green shirt.
He is the one in the green shirt. That's his color.
Oh man, this is gonna be fun. I can already tell. So two years to record.
So that first year was that. First 2 years, okay, this is like a record deal. The second year was like a little bit more disillusioned. Then by the third year, okay, I should probably go to college or something and get an education in America, you know. And then
did you have another job or was it just music?
Always music. Never had a real job my whole life.
Love that.
Then college didn't work out. I didn't get accepted, but I didn't get rejected either. It was like a limbo of like, you know, financial aid office is like, do you have any money? And then... You know,
talk to my label.
Yeah.
Were you considered an international student?
Yeah, I was considered.
So that makes it more difficult.
Yeah, it's like they didn't know where to put me because it's like, well, you live here, but you're like, it's like, yeah, that's like another, you know, thing. And then what? Oh, yeah, I've heard about the International Blues Challenge where it's like once a year, these bands from all over the world, they go to Memphis, Tennessee, and they compete for this title of like, you know, the best blues band or, you know, some stuff like that. And then all the industry is there, all the record labels of the blues industry and all the festival promoters and all the festival owners. So it's like, okay, I'll put a blues band together. We'll like rehearse the shit out of it, right? Because the reason I play guitar is because of American blues musicians, you know, of the 50s right. and 30s right. and 40s, you know. And I go to Memphis and we would make it to the semifinals, but that like opened my eyes to the industry of blues music and the business. It doesn't exist. It's like a retiree community that plays Halloween, right? It's like the doctors and lawyers that dress up as bluesmen from the 50s and they're like, yeah, I have the same harmonica that little Walter used to have, yeah, but also, you know, I have like a house in the Hamptons, you know. So it's like, is that blues, you know? And it's like, then I started realizing that actually, like, modern contemporary music, I was like trying to like relate to the music of teenagers of the 50s and I'm like separated so far. So it's like I've tried that blues challenge like three years in a row. By the last year I was like, no, because one of the criteria on which they judge you is the originality and blues content. So it's like stay within the frame very originally, but like not, it's like who defines the ramification of the flower? So I wrote these like songs and, you know, everyone liked them, but like the judges, you know, that you have this panel of like just, you know, sitting like that and judging your band, you know, and the whole industry.
Bunch of stiffs.
Yeah, just stiffs. So
sounds like the participants in it were more in it for the expensive hobby
rather than a business model. Right? If you had to pick one of us who those judges looked most like, who would it be?
Like, no, all of you. Like, that would be the panel. Yeah,
you're
like,
but who specifically looked the most like the people on the panel?
Who looks the stiffest?
Probably that guy.
Behind the camera.
Yeah.
I love it. So the blues thing didn't work out.
It didn't work out, but you know, like it allowed me to realize of like the extent of nature of the bands and the industry and the lack of industry and the lack of money and whatever and the competitive and the good old boys club.
Yeah.
Of who decides who's going to play at the Sarasota Blues Festival, who decides who's going to play at the Brandon Blues Festival. And it's like everybody knows everybody and all the hands are shaking and all the pockets are, you know, full of like ice cream, whatever, you know, like they like exchange the cones already, you know, so it's like good luck getting into that one, you know. And then YouTube, I started exploring that in 2016, nothing, 2017, nothing. And then September 2017. Hurricane Irma, remember that one?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, was evacuating, lost cellular service somewhere in Alabama, connected to a Wi-Fi, and I saw that one of the videos, I had like zero subscribers, right? And one of the videos had like 6,000 views. I'm like, oh my God, I'll be able to show this to the bar owner where I played this, and instead of 150 for 4 hours, I'll ask for 200.
Ooh.
That's going to be really good. And then I check it like a few hours later, it's like 10,000. And then the next day, 100,000 views. And then like a week later, over a million. And then it's like Guitar World Magazine wrote an article. Guitar Owner Magazine wrote an article.
Oh, shit.
Then like some TV channel in Holland like did a thing, you know. And I was like, oh my God, is this going to be a one-hit wonder? But it's like the concept is like someone requested a song and I played it. And it's sort of like a challenge, kind of like, is he going to fake it? Is he going to fail? Is it going to be good? And then that happens to musicians all the time. Musicians get requested, you know, Freebird, do you know? Like, Hotel California, whatever, right? So it's like, and I was doing and filming all the gigs, you know? So I just like, okay, I'm going to post more when someone requests. Viral. So like by 2018.
You had your niche.
Yeah, it's like, and then other formats came about when they like send me like a guitar, and I'm like, I titled the video. They send me a free guitar because I make YouTube videos that like an unboxing, me opening a box and just being goofy with the guitar, like hits like 500,000 views in like a week, like the hell. Or like, you know, singer steals a show. So then that, like a TV producer of some sort, you know, that they figure out what TV shows work, like Family Feud or like Got Talent format, or I don't know, some kind of like, you know, when, you know, they ask a question, it's like whoever clicks the buzzer first, and then sort of like a competitiveness. So the same psychology almost applies when it comes to like creating content for YouTube. Like even this, you know, this is like started with like Jimmy Carson, and then, you know, later with like Letterman, and then the format became thanks to the internet, you know, it's like easier to like podcasts and four people talking, and here I am, it's essentially like three Jimmy Kimmels, right? And I'm the guest, you know, so it's like and then these concepts and formats are transformable, you know, and you can like recycle them and shift them, you know. So it's like I found what television has been doing for years, but you can do it yourself.
Yeah.
You know, and almost like take control of your narrative and the way you represent your brand, you know.
So that was like a 5-year overnight success story, right? Like you put in the work, like, but then it just happened overnight.
Yeah, it seems like, yeah, yeah, oh yeah, it's fine. Yeah, you know, and even now it's like not even like, you know, halfway, you know.
So what was it that you took a song that resonated with people that was popular, and you did it in your style, and kind of what do you think it was?
It wasn't even popular. It was
made it go viral.
What was the song that went viral the first time?
Okay, Steve Vai, Tender Surrender. You wouldn't even know.
Don't even know
exactly.
Well, we're not musicians, Felipe.
No, you know? Don't know. Is it difficult to play? Or
exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So it's like known as like an impossible. Mm-hmm. Steve Vai. You ask any guitarist to play Steve Vai, it's like shit out of luck. You're like, it's like not happening. So it's like maybe the title and the thumbnail almost seemed like a joke, and then halfway through me faking it, it's like I'm able to deliver enough of an entertaining, compelling performance. So it's like, well, it's not note to note. Of course, it's never going to be. But it's like, it sounds like music, you know?
So is he one of those like guitarists that is guitarist known really well, but everybody else doesn't, like a Joe Satriani or something?
Yeah, dude, you have the friends. They're like 10 years apart. Yeah,
I understand what you're saying.
They toured together. Yeah, Joe Satriani.
People who play guitar, they love that stuff, and I'm like, this is a bit
esoteric.
This is a bit esoteric for me, you know?
Oh, yeah, because their audience is everyone who also plays guitar.
Correct. Right. Like, all right.
Yeah.
Takes one to know one, right?
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that happened, and then what? And then you just doubled down on it? Like, yeah. I mean, it's taken off, so it's just, all right, this is what I'm doing
from
this point
on. Yeah, every day, and just almost like, well, you're a businessman, so you would understand. There's like a wide funnel, you know, where you like get everybody, right? And then the percentage of that converts to like, okay, we're going to check out the originals. And then the percentage of that become like diehard fans. And then the percentage of that, they also buy the merch, and then they join the mailing list, you know? So it's like almost like expanding the net with like really wide, big videos. When someone requests a song, and the singer steals the show. You won't believe what happens next. Whatever, you know, that not too sensational, you know. I haven't done, it's like,
not
I don't,
clickbait, but.
Yeah, not clickbait, right. You know, because I haven't done like slime challenge or I flip a car or something, you know. It's like, it's within the rules that it has to be me playing music, and I want to use the internet as a vehicle for my musicianship, to where I post a video, hey, come see me play live on a 4-day notice. 300 people came yesterday, wow. You know. Yeah, so it's like, and that's why I played for like 4 hours, you know, because it's like, my mentality is like, you're not here for me, I'm here for you, you know. So it's like, yeah, listen, you know, and enjoy, and I want to meet everybody, you know. So
yeah. That's awesome. Yeah, so you mentioned when singer steals the show. It seems like everyone that comes up and sings with you could win American Idol, right? Is there ever any ones when they get up,
which is obviously the epitome of music,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I post those too.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Because then it's now no longer about the range of the vocal excellence. It's more of like, it's courage, and it's also fun to do music. And music should not be gatekeeped based on the excellence. Oh, I'm not a singer, so I'm not going to get up. You know, it's like, you know, pre-technology, in the primordial times of humanity, when people just hung out around the fire, you know, everyone participated socially and did something, you know. So I like to invite people and share the moment, even if they're like amateur by the standards of whoever would be the judges, you know. Right. It's like, I don't know the words. I'm like, pull up the words and look at it on your phone, you know. And it's sort of like a beautiful moment. And then afterwards, they tell me they had so much fun. It's like they always dreamed of singing, or it's like they never sang in front of an audience and microphone. And then, you know, they get off and then people shake their hand and it's like, you know, you were really good. Or you were like, you know, and they become friends, awesome. You know? So yeah. It's just an overall beautiful moment, you know?
I love the campfire analogy because, you know, before we had like TVs and, you know, all this electronics and stuff, what were we doing? Like just stuff like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, what you're really doing when you show those videos is you're illustrating your deep connection with the people who love your music and,
yeah,
and you're kind of going, there's an interchange both ways rather than just them watching you.
Exactly. It's not like you're not playing music at them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's so, and some musicians misunderstand the whole concept of playing. Well, I believe, you know, I think, you know, like if an instrument is an extension of you, so during the performance, the room and the audience is the extension of the instrument too. So when you are playing, you're playing with them. So you almost, just like you tune the pegs of the guitar to make sure it's in tune, you're also, that's why there is like a warm-up band or there's like an ambience dimage in lights, you know, to set the mood, to actually tune the people to what's about to happen, to where they're like, you know. And there are moments, if you do everything right, every heart will beat at the BPM of the song and everyone will move, you know, so it'll create sort of like very rare, almost like a pulsating, like your neurons, you know, sending a thought and it'll pulsate at a pattern, but like different human beings will behave like a set of neurons interlinked. You know, and you can do that with music.
The kids these days, I think they call that a vibe, right?
Yeah.
It's a vibe. That's all I'm thinking about. It's a vibe.
It's a vibe, yeah.
It's a vibe.
Yeah. Oh, that was a vibe yesterday, dude. Yeah.
So what did you do yesterday? Was you were in Orlando?
I was in Sarasota. The Shriners, they have this like performance hall. And
over on Beneva?
Beneva, yeah. Yeah.
That's a nice facility they got there.
How much longer are you down?
Till Monday.
Are you gonna do any other gigs?
I might do St. Armands Saturday night. If they don't it's
throw
not
you
raining.
Off. They don't throw you off there.
I
anymore.
Did last Saturday, and I did turn it up. And I was like, because noise ordinance is at 10 p.m. Yeah, yeah. And I went like 40 minutes after. I wanted for the cops to show up. No one came. It's like there's probably a rumor. It's like, as you know, don't.
Yeah,
you
it's
know?
Helping him. It's helping.
Yeah,
him.
Yeah, yeah. Because it's like for me, you know, it's like there's a well.
You want to explain the beef with St. Armand's cops?
Oh, yeah, of course.
And, you know, this is a great... The noise ordinance is always a fun topic around here not everybody knows about, but with your experience, you know, you've been on the other end of the noise ordinance, like, literally. Yeah.
Oh, God. No, so St. Armand's, if anything, I should be thankful because they made me so much money because when Rachel hired a law firm to send me a cease and desist... I read it on video.
I remember that.
Rachel is the director of St. Armand's Circle Association. Okay. I no longer live here, so I get to say her name. You know, so but she has like a personal vendetta against me, which is fine. You know, it's good to have enemies. You know, you're fully living. You know, it's not like she's my enemy, but I guess she perceives me. I got told by former employees of St. Armand's Circle Associations that they would have meetings in like a closed room where Rachel would like show my videos on the projector and would be fuming, you know? Like, how dare he, you know? And it's just me reading the cease and desist letter and then announcing the merch because the cease and desist had a spelling error.
Oh,
govern
goodness.
Yourselves accordingly. They missed the
accordingly.
R.
Accordingly.
That merch
sold
out.
You put it on the merch?
Like that.
Did you put it on the merch?
I put it on the merch.
That's great.
Mugs, t-shirts. So it's like, thank you, Rachel, you know? And then I had like, it like blew up to the point where the former mayor called me, Hagen Brody. Yeah, and then he set up a meeting with Rachel and kind of like, you know, I said, look, okay, send me a letter and like called me like an ambassador of music or something. Then I'll make a video like, you know,
right.
It's like, you know, political bargaining.
Goodwill.
Yeah, it's like, right. You know, like nothing, don't give me the key to the city yet, you know,
right.
But like call me like an ambassador of Sarasota music or something for the internet. They didn't do that. You know, it's politicians. They overpromise and underdeliver, which is fine. It's on brand, you know, but I did get a letter, you know, it's like Sarasota is the city of the arts and, you know, the integral part of it and you and blah 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 and the misunderstanding and it's like, you know, signed by the thing and it's like, and then I got a
official stamp.
Yeah, it's official stamp. So
kind of an apology?
No.
Not really an apology.
Of course not.
But I mean, you know, we bill ourselves as like this cultural center and we do have a lot of working artists here per capita.
Well,
right?
Yeah.
But then when you actually want to do the art on the street,
no, it's self-congratulatory, you know? So whenever they give, like, a Lifetime Achievement Award to anybody, and I saw this in Oppenheimer movie, and it was, like, a really interesting concept.
How was that, by the way?
Great movie.
I need to go
great
see
movie.
It.
Great movie.
Did you like it?
No, it's tough. It's depressing. If you watch it in the beginning of the day, you're going to have a bad day and sad because a lot of people died, right? If you watch it at the end of the day, you're going to have nightmares.
Where you see Barbie and that back to back. And
I saw Barbie first and then Oppenheimer. Should have done the other way. She's like Oppenheimer and then Barbie.
Then Barbie, yeah. Finish it off.
But no, the concept when they give somebody like a lifetime achievement award, they don't do it for the person; they did it for themselves to make feel better about themselves. You know, it's you've seen the movie, you saw that. It's like Einstein told him when they give you an award, they're not going to give it.
They build you up and then they break you down.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, so. But we're getting derailed here. I did laminate the letter, you know, hoping that I would get like, you know, somebody would call noise ordinance on me and I would pull out the mayor's letter, you know. But it hasn't happened. And then I left and I moved out of Sarasota, know.
That's great.
Do you have the letter tonight?
It's probably in my house in California right now. So yeah, I didn't bring it with me. But the cop who shut me down and actually was like going out of her way to use city's resources to dispatch extra patrols during the days what I would be playing there to make sure that, you know, you get like one, two, third ticket, you go to jail, you get arrested. She like really like went out because like she even talked to the I know some insider information because I have fans, you know, different places. I have fans on the force.
You got eyes everywhere.
Yeah, yeah. It's like Saruman, you know. It's like you can't hide, you know. Yeah.
Hey, listen, we are having an absolute blast here with my man Dovydas, who could probably take me in arm wrestling, but gave me gave me the win, and obviously I cheated. But get to know him a little bit better with this next section, the rapid fire questions.
This is Dovydas, and this is rapid fire. Willy Wonka in the Chocolate Factory. That's not what the movie is called, but it's the with Gene Wilder one.
We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams.
That's the version, not the Timothée Chalamet. You know, that's not the real one.
Okay, then, let's move along.
I would be like 30-year-old non-musician applying to take guitar lessons right now.
And the legend of the wrench was way hardcore. Yeah.
I kind of live like that already.
You know, that's just like your opinion, man.
Oreo cookie family pack, but like the whole thing, I can destroy it under 10 minutes.
Nom 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 nom. Oh, nom 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 nom.
Ah. I come in peace.
That back there is not real.
Don't report me to the government.
Welcome to Earth.
Britney, my first CD I've ever bought, that was before I played guitar, it was Britney Spears In the Zone. And it's like, I watched the British version on MTV at the time. That was like, that was like the life I wanted to live.
Hit me, baby, one more time.
I would probably write it myself.
Woo!
It would have like guitar and maybe like horns and like for I don't know, I'm blanking, but it's like duh, duh, you know, and I would definitely do that. You know? I actually got asked that once by a waitress. She's like, "Are you a professional waitress? Are you a professional?" Or hold on, she said, "Are you? I have a question. Are you a wrestler?" And I said, "I didn't answer. I said, do you want me to wrestle you?" And she choked. She didn't know what to say.
Yeah.
Not yet. That was later. I signed a lease.
No, God, please, no, no.
Yes, I thought I did the screwing, but I was the one who got screwed, so. Yeah, I'm not from America, so I'll just go with like with the two, because the number two is larger than, you know, the just one, right? So I'm vaguely familiar, but I'm just making a joke on as a pun, you know, whatever. Oh, there's like a list of people. Actually, there's some are like within the realm of possibility. So within the realm of impossibility, everyone who's dead. Well, Elvis is still alive. He just went home.
Thank you very much.
But out of the living ones, you know, I've been listening to a lot of Drake, you know, so like probably Drake and 21 Savage. I could be 22 Savage, you know. Or something.
Sorry.
All right, so obviously, you know, you're on YouTube now. You know, you're not doing as much of your own original music, correct, at that point? Or is still a lot of original?
A lot of original. Okay. Yeah, it just happens that the when someone requests format is, like, the most popular.
Okay.
You know.
So how do you develop, like, how did you develop your unique style? Like, your original music is obviously fairly unique. Obviously, you love the blues and mm-hmm. you've got a background in that. But your style is, it wouldn't, how would you define your style? Let's start there.
It's like heavily improvisational. Even when I was like 15 and I would get hired to play at like a yacht club or do you have 3 hours worth of material? And like, yes, I don't.
I just make it up.
Yeah. Right. So it's like almost like need driven, but also you channel creativity and inspiration in real time to like pull it out of you, even when you, it seems like you don't have it, but you do have it. You always have it. You can always come up with like a new idea, you know? So essentially that. And then using that energy, even if they are people requesting a cover that the song that they've heard multiple times, human memory is not a DVD. They can't rewind it and, well, actually you didn't play that right, or didn't, especially if they're not even a musician. Mm-hmm. So if you can like use the vibe, and that's like 10%, the rest, it's me. I get to do whatever I want with a song. Even if I don't know the lyrics, you know, I can do like, you know, I got my first in six string, something, something, I don't know the words. And they're forgiving. They're like, haha, that's funny. You know, he just goes with it anyways.
Artistic,
you know,
license, right?
Exactly, yeah. They're like on your side. They want you to like also, you know, be part of it, you know. So it's essentially very, very much creative liberty, and then feeling feedback from observing fast, not just visually, but you know, like I might be like the head is down, but like somebody's like, whoa, it's like, oh, okay, more of that, you know. Yeah. It's like in the moment, you know, because you're playing for the people. You're not like, this is the piece and I'm gonna read it from start to finish and I'm like not gonna stop, not gonna change anything, even if it's like boo, but you should, you know, probably.
Even if it's boo.
Yeah, well, I've never had a boo. Okay. Yeah, I never had a boo. Yeah, but you know, you have to like kind of like adapt. Yeah, adapt over. What's that? Beer grills, you know, the saying.
Adapt and overcome.
Yeah. Improvise. Yeah, adapt, overcome, improvise. Yeah, you're wearing camo. You should know.
That's a golf shirt. Celebrating Wallen Wednesday today with the boots and everything. We do that in the office.
Anyways. Okay. Okay.
Anyway, so you develop your own kind of style and improv and you know the normal course of, you know, what music was doing, the industry anyways, didn't work for you.
No.
Fast forward to now. Are you kind of half traditional, half, you know, digital, online YouTube, or is it still full on YouTube?
It's
all on your own.
It's full on. I've been approached by like traditional, old school thinking, either like labels or agencies or you know,
they're trying to reel you back in.
Well, yeah, because they see the numbers
now.
Now
so you
it's
got
like
some numbers behind.
We've always believed in you. And it's like, no, you know, no, go kiss a frog, you know, or something, you know, yeah. So there are like YouTubers who are not even musicians, but they will sell out a room for a meet and greet. You know, and it won't even be a traditional venue with tickets and usher and promoter and posters, you know, before the show and in the set list and the sound guy and the light guy. So it's like I'm realizing that I don't need to follow any rules of the musician's world. They don't apply, and I shouldn't even like look at the rule book of the how to musician. Like, no, I can't.
Musicians for dummies.
Yeah, exactly. I can go like full how to Kardashian with like that, use that as a vehicle for my music through YouTube.
So what I'm hearing is your music style is improvisation.
Yeah.
And your business style is also a little bit of improvisation.
You have to. Yeah. That's what like entrepreneur means, right? To I'm thinking of a funny. Yeah. It actually means improvise. It comes from a French word that it does not. It does
Where
not.
Does that word
the
come
Latin
from?
Root is. No, I'm just kidding.
I was waiting for You're someone waiting to for jump it. In. I had yeah, it going. It's like no. Some expertise.
I did not take Latin.
That's Latin took you.
Maybe.
So what's a day in the life of Dovydas look like these days?
Well, God, I wake up at 11 or 12. I go to Waffle House.
Where are you based out of, L.A.?
Los Angeles, yeah. Cool. Well, there's no Waffle House in Los Angeles, but yeah.
You wish you went to Waffle House. You just go to the L.A. substitute.
Yeah, yeah. Well, for the last 2 months, I've been on the road. So I left L.A. and I've been, like, you know, stopping anywhere. I like staying there as long as...
Nashville? Were you in Nashville?
I was in Nashville for quite a bit, you know. So there's not, like, a daily schedule. It's kind of like some days I'll just wake up. Like, where do I want to go now?
Was you
like
improvise.
6 hour radius.
Do you improvise.
That's how I came to Florida.
Yeah.
Do you have a permanent, like, home base? Do you, like, have a house you rent out?
Yeah, yeah. It's a house with, like, 50 of my guitars in, like, in Calabasas, gated community. You know, it's, yeah. So it's, like, you know, it's locked up. It's fine. You know,
okay, cool.
It's probably mail piled up now, you know, so I'll have to check it.
Yeah. Yeah. Fan mail.
God, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I love how you describe your house as primarily for your guitars.
Yeah, it's like, I need to get rid of it because it's, like, you know, there comes a number.
It's a very expensive storage unit.
It is. Well, yes, you're not wrong. It's, like, if you have, like, a little bit of something, you own it. But if you have, like, a lot of something, that a lot of something owns
it
you.
It owns you.
So that's what it's like. I had to get, like, a big house, you know, I'm going to sell most of those guitars. Or, like, give away half, or sell half or something. You know, it's just too many.
Fan giveaway, maybe?
Yeah, yeah. There I could. Yeah. I've done those, yeah. People. Oh, really? Well, the problem with that, you do, like, a video giveaway one, and then I get, like 1,000 DMs. My dog died and 5 years ago, I really need a guitar. I have 5 of these, and I could really use. And please,
can it's more depressing than Oppenheimer movie.
Yeah, yeah. It's just like it keeps going. Can I have gold hardware, by the way? If it's not too much. Anyways, here's my address. And it's like I get hit like, you know, it becomes like a guitar charity kind of thing. You know, so I'd rather do it quietly. Yeah.
Yeah, I love that. So there's no real. Structured day in the life of you. That's you're not, improvising.
Well, I'm in the gym. Okay,
the gym. That's
yes. Okay. I have to go to the gym.
You so how do you manage the gym when you're on the road? Whereas some people can't even manage to make it to the gym when they have a routine life.
I think that's why they can't manage the gym because they have a routine life.
Okay.
So yeah, if it's after midnight, if it's a 24-hour gym, you know, I'm there. You know.
So where do you work out around here?
I have a couple of memberships. You know, EOS, and I'll go to Crunch. But sometimes it gets too crowded, you know.
Very much so.
Yeah, and then in L.A., I'll go to Equinox. But all of the L.A. gyms, they close at 10, you know. So you have to, like, I have to, like, move my day.
You'd think L.A. would have a 24-hour gym.
They used to, pre-COVID. Yeah, and then I said, dude, they're, like, still, like, you know, Florida was YOLO. L.A. was, like, I heard was strict. And there's, like, still, like, remnants in the air of all the controls and, you know, all the...
Yeah, metaphorically and literally, huh?
Yeah. You're right.
So was COVID good for your business? Because I know that, like, the views on YouTube...
Everyone was on the internet. Yeah. It was ridiculous. Oh, my God.
So you couldn't do much live playing, maybe?
Yeah, but I was live streaming every day for, like, 5-6 hours a day, just from the room, you know,
from
just
the room,
playing
yeah.
song requests.
Is that on YouTube or on Twitch, or what is it?
It was multicast. Started on YouTube, then somebody told me of Restream, and then Restream can cast on, like, Twitch and Periscope at the time. Periscope's dead now.
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, like, you know, Twitch and YouTube I was doing, yeah.
Do you have a team that helps you with your editing and everything now, or what is it just you?
It's me solo. I was about to, like,
that's wild.
Had like management or something, and
something tells me you and management don't really mesh.
Yeah. No, so check this out. I needed a gig, right? Okay, like, book me a gig. It's a wine shit bar in Atlanta, Georgia, right? I want to play there because I know it has high foot traffic, really good light. You know, it's, like, conducive to what I do, the way I want video to look, and the sound is, like, it's going to be perfect. Enough strangers to, like, what do you like? We want to hear this. It's a banger. Everyone's dancing on camera. Beautiful for YouTube. And then...
Which is almost more important than what the gig actually pays
you. Exactly.
So you film all your gigs like that?
I have not done a gig that I haven't filmed since 2016.
Who holds the camera for you?
That's smart.
Yeah, hire different people.
Okay.
Yeah, either like talent on site, Craigslist, or I'll fly somebody in if I can't find anybody. Yeah, I have like people on like 24-hour notice.
Any Craigslist horror stories from doing that?
No, probably.
So you've had good luck.
I've used, yeah, like very minimally, you know. And then the management... they're like, did you talk? And like, oh, it was, they already had someone booked. I'm like, did you offer money? Oh, we didn't think of that. So that let me know when the time comes for like Grammys or Oscars or getting a role in the movie, these are not the people to represent.
No shit.
They couldn't negotiate. They couldn't like
a shit wine bar
pay off $200 to some musician to not play. So I get to, it's like, how do you, okay. So you're a business owner, right?
Yeah. We all are, I guess.
You all are. Right. So how do you like, a skill that's called thinking outside of the box. Can you train that?
No.
Exactly. It's like a character trait. It's like they can have a resume, right? And they've done all these things, and it's like really cool on LinkedIn. You know, they have the proper pictures and, you know, the high recommendations. It's like, it was not available. But did you think of this? No.
Meaning they didn't think. That's really what it is.
Yeah. 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 So, but yeah, been up to this point, been solo. I did find like outsourcing certain tasks that I'm very good at doing, but it, at this point, it's just time consuming. So I have, you know, 1, 2, 3, like 3 camera angles and like audio, you know, so I know how to drop all of that into Adobe Premiere, mix and master, you know, all the audio, and then, you know, synchronize all the 3 cameras, you know, to like to a clap, you know. So I have somebody else do the whole sequence, because my thing is like 3-hour segments. I'll do like 2-3-hour thing. So 3 cameras, 3 hours worth of footage, and then 3-hour audio, you know, and then I make the call judgment like a chief editor,
clips,
you know.
Are good.
Yeah. So, well, you don't know what's good, what's not good until you actually post it.
True.
So I thought, I had videos that I thought, oh, this is shit.
You always hear that too. It's the one that you didn't expect.
Yeah,
to
and
blow
it's like,
up.
I don't know what to post today. I'm just gonna post this shitty video, right? It just blows up, you know. So that's when I learned. Okay, I'm gonna post everything because I don't know what's good, what's not good.
I love that.
You know,
that's what we did with the podcast, man. When we started, it was just like, let's roll with it. Let's just figure it out. You know, we got a good concept. We wanted to be more involved locally in everything that we're doing, and just ran out with it, and it's worked out pretty well.
People seem to really like hearing about roundabouts, you know?
Yeah, what can we say? Roundabouts are sexy.
So, yeah, so you're established in the States now. Is there anything about Lithuania that you really missed?
Oh, God. I left when I was 19, and at 19, you know, you don't get to... You drive a car in Europe since you're 18, so I didn't even like spend that much time there as an adult. So I was mainly there as a child, a kid, you know, a teenager, you know. So the only nostalgia that I have, I don't think it's because of Lithuania, of because of nostalgia for the childhood that is associated to the geographical location.
Okay,
you know, so that's the missing part. But it's contingent to time. 2023 Lithuania, I don't want to go there. I want to see 2008 Lithuania, but there's no time machine, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you mentioned businessmen several times. If you can't tell, my questions are really pointed at how is Dovydas mainly generating revenue, right? Like, you're obviously getting ad revenue on YouTube. Mm-hmm. You're filming these gigs that you're doing and whatnot, but you're not really booking like stadiums, and you're not touring on a grand scale. So all of that is just feeding your YouTube channel. So Would it be fair to say like 80%, 90%, most of what you do is YouTube ad revenue, merch, stuff that, like that?
Facebook ad revenue. So, you know, there's like 1.5 million on YouTube. There's 700,000 on Facebook.
Wow.
Which is like a completely different set of eyeballs. Big time, because different demographics use Facebook for different reasons. In some countries, Facebook is their whole internet. Right. They don't even use Google to search. They use Facebook. That's the whole internet, you know? Like, I have like... freaking fan base in Philippines and Thailand that, like, you know, I've actually had people recognize me. So like, I'll travel, like I'll get recognized at a grocery store, at a pharmacy, whatever. Like, oh, I love all your Facebook videos. They only know me from Facebook, you know, not even YouTube, you know.
That's so crazy.
You know, that affiliate links, brand deals,
do you have a band that you do things with? Like you said, you
I'll like hire a bass player and the drummer, but lately has not been contingent, you know, like conducive to the way I do things, because like then I'm like responsible for the lodging and traveling and coordination, and then those people have lives, and then they have like jobs too, you know. So it's like I wish I could just find people who like have no schedule.
So you would have to be more scheduled than you want to be if you use them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like if it's just me, or they would have to be available on 24-hour notice, which is like unreasonable and unrealistic, you know, unless they're like in the short proximity, that if it's like locally. So that's why I was able to swing this on the 4-day notice and have like a drummer and the bass player and the saxophone player and the piano player, and then invite like a bunch of guests to come steal the show, you know, yesterday. So, yeah. And but with solo...
No. How does that work? The gig you played yesterday. Can you expound about how you got all the other people that play with?
Yeah, these are people you just played with previously, or you knew, or Craigslist, or what?
So I lived in Sarasota for 10 years. So like I have
a network here.
Yeah, there's like a network, you know. And then a bass player and the drummer. That's kind of like the core of the rhythm section, and you know the bass of the band. And then Veer Hill, he stole a show from me once. Incredible singer, also plays keys and does lives in Sarasota now, by the way, and does gigs locally. So I really wanted him to come play with me. So he was also available. He had a day off. Then we were going to do it outside, and we're going to go use the PA of the bass player. And then I saw that they have like a performance hall inside, and it's like, okay, well, I definitely need to hire somebody to run sound. So I hired somebody to run sound on like a 12-hour notice, right? And then all the people, guests, I just texted a bunch of people the day before, hey, come to the show. And some people were, oh, we were planning on being there anyways, you know? So yeah, what an honor, you know, thanks for inviting me, you know? And I like, probably like had like 10 guests, I think. And I forgot some, cause it's like a lot to manage, you know? And then, you know, running like a 4-hour show with no set list. Cause most people have like, you know, like even you have like show notes, right? You know, I have like, you know, nothing. So it's like, what do I want to play next? And it's like, I don't need to think how to be, cause I'm just being myself. So right. I will say on the microphone, what do I want to play next? You know? And people are laughing, you know, cause they're like, they already have developed a parasocial relationship with me because they've seen me on their smart TV so many times. So they're like, they feel like they know me. I've never met them.
Yeah, that's the power of branding, right?
It's incredible, you know? So I even got like, okay, I want to see like how much, you know, can I do? So I did like, everyone did the Freddy moment. Every single person.
That's awesome.
It's like, oh my God, the crowd is like tuned. It's like, you know, perfect. Yeah, it was really cool.
So how do the economics of that work? Because you're paying these guys to do the gig with you. I'm sure you're sometimes paying for the gig or getting paid. You've got to pay somebody to run sound. Do you have an idea of what, you know, hey, if I film 3 hours and I put this into a 30-minute YouTube video, 20-minute YouTube video, this is what I'm going to earn off of ad revenue and whatever else? Or are you just winging it and you know it's going to work out? Or like,
yeah, I'm just winging it. And yeah, I know that the whatever it's going to cost, it's worth it because it'll pay off in like by thousands of percents.
That's awesome.
It's not even 100. It's like, oh, 200. No.
Right, because you own all the content. Right?
Yes.
And you're just going directly to the consumer.
Think of it as a mine, right? Or fishing. Maybe like fishing. No, not fishing. I'm thinking of it as like a diamond mine, right? So I have the tools and I know the location. And for anyone else, it's just like some set of rocks. It's like, no, I have the exact tool. I know exactly how to transport it, you know, to my refinery, which is my laptop, you know, and then I refine it. And then it's like all of a sudden, it's like blingy and shiny. And it's like, oh my God, this is amazing. Because every musician, any musician you meet that performs live, they all will have stories of amazing moments. Imagine the storytelling value if it's captured on video, and then everyone's gonna, well, I'm just gonna put my phone and film wide angle. Now imagine if it's captured on video, but like with intentionality of filming it right. Mm-hmm. You know, the way, not necessarily like, don't go full Scorsese, you know, or like, you know, Kubrick, but just enough. Don't do like wide angle, let me see everybody, and just hold it. But just, you know, that, yeah, it's like, you can't even quantify it because yes, there's ad revenue, but then there's people who discover you and you registered in the brain. And then three years later, they see a poster that you're going to be in the town near you. They're going to come to the show. They're going to buy merch. They're going to buy a hat and a t-shirt. Then they're going to take a picture with you after the show. They're going to send that picture to their niece and the nephew. And then the niece and the nephew, they're going to listen to you on the Spotify after they're done watching Netflix on a Friday night when they were staying in and drinking red wine, you know, two glasses in. And then they're going to have like an amazing, like romantic moment with the music. Then they, yeah, it's like,
I'm there.
It's just geometrical progression. Yeah, it's like the value of it and the impact on humans' lives. You know, yeah,
that's awesome, amazing. I mean, I'm freaking speechless because that's like every musician's dream. I feel like is just to do what you're doing. You know, be authentic, be yourself, not have to worry about the business side of music, right? Because you're playing music because you love music. You're not playing music because you wanted to be, you know, a billionaire musician.
Yeah,
it's just the income of it is really just the outcome of that authenticity.
Yeah, it's like a byproduct. Yeah, yeah, exactly. And then, you know, to get to do your passion, you know, and then, oh, it works, you know, and then, yeah, I try to like reflect to myself, you know, the attitude of gratitude, you know, because sometimes mammalian brain has evolved to look for problems, like no matter where you are in life, at what level.
No kidding.
It's like,
right, we have a negative bias because that's what protects us
out
in the wild, right?
You know, so it's like, I'm like, you have to be like consciously teaching yourself to like, bruh, we have so good here.
Oh shit. I think your background from Lithuania helps you there too, right?
Yeah, because like where I come from, no one makes it out of there. Like, not in the sense that, well, Charles Bronson, but he wasn't even born in Lithuania. He was Lithuanian.
He was.
Yeah. Okay. Charles Bronson. Carlos.
I bet you Felipe knew that. I didn't know that.
I did not know that. That's a fun fact, though.
His real name is Carlos Buczynskis.
I see why he changed it.
Oh, yeah. Round and round, round and round. I get around. Still clown with the underground. When we come around.
This segment on Roundabouts is brought to you by Terminator Law. If you've been in an accident on a roundabout, on the highway, downtown Sarasota, anywhere in Sarasota, make sure you reach out to Tom. He's going to get you the compensation you deserve.
Well, so you spent 10 years in Sarasota.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know a little bit about Sarasota. So let's talk some, you know, Sarasota-based stuff.
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, so a question we ask every guest. What are your feelings on roundabouts? Do you love them? Do you hate them?
Well, I'm from Europe, so I'm used to the concept. So like for me, I came to the States, and there wasn't enough roundabouts. And whenever I would encounter one, like nobody knew how to operate it. It's like they didn't read the owner's manual or something, which is fine. You know, it's a cultural thing, and you know, if you don't use it a lot, but I don't know. There has to be like someone who designs the roads, right? And someone like who measures the traffic flow. Because I've seen, don't they like they throw out that tube strip, right, on the road, and they
measure the traffic.
They probably measure the traffic flow, and they make a call. But it could be not only motivated by the flow of traffic or increasing its efficiency. I'm sure it's like someone wins a contract to build a roundabout, and there's probably like a lot of money made in there. So there's like probably different factors of motivation.
It's the good old boys club too.
Yeah, probably just like in music. Yeah, so probably in construction, you know, someone like gets a handshake, and now they get to like, and then you see Bob's Barricades or Acme Barricades, right? So you know, they also everybody makes money, you know.
I love it.
And then the road, like what, like 2 years? It's like in a shit condition for 2 years. So yeah, so whoever's like overseeing the whole thing, they're like that. But no, they're like, they're biased to look for negativity. So even though they're like cashing in big time, they're probably also worrying.
No
just
doubt.
Like, just, yeah, we are.
So overall, you like roundabouts?
I mean, I don't like, I like flying and I like boats. I don't like driving cars. It's like too much rules.
I was going to ask you if you have like a camper van you're traveling the country with or how you're getting around.
No, I like room service too much.
How'd you get here?
I like room service.
So in my car, but then my car got hit in Indiana. So now I'm in a rental.
Beautiful. I meant physically here to the podcast
today. Oh, with a car.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, cars.
A chopper.
Yeah. Come with me if you want to live.
That's Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
He knows that one. Awesome, man. Well, you know, before we wrap up, people probably know where to find you, but if they don't, where would they find?
Blockbuster Video, Radio Shack, and if you have a Costco membership, my CDs are next to the vitamin aisle.
That's good.
You just Google Dovydas, right?
Yeah, that's it.
I love it.
Yeah.
A question we ask every guest, you know, coming on, you spent 10 years here. We love the music track we're on too. Anybody that, and it doesn't have to be music, but anybody that you would recommend we get on that Sarasota needs to hear from?
Oh, quite a few people. As a friend of mine, she actually helps run a bunch of nonprofits that benefit Sarasota okay. greatly. Her name's Ruta, R-U-T-A, and her last name is Juniari. You don't have to spell that. I mean, I can give you the spelling in like a private setting. Or, you know, and then I think you should have Veer Hill. So the video I did with Veer is like over 20 million views now.
Holy smokes.
And that essentially like launched his career. I think his channel is over like 50, 60,000 subscribers. So as far as I'm concerned, he's like the most successful YouTube musician that actually lives in Sarasota now and does gigs regularly here.
Okay.
And his story is really interesting. He's a really interesting man. He's from St. Martin, and he lived like in the New Hampshire for like quite a bit and did gigs there, and he was just visiting Sarasota because I think his like family or girlfriend was living here, and now he like moved and then he's like here, you know, so like
happens a lot.
Yeah. So I did a show with him yesterday, so of course, yeah, you definitely should have him, you know, because he's a Veer Hill, so V-E-R-E Hill, like just like a blueberry hill.
Blueberry Hill, yeah. It's the first thing that comes to mind for me. Yeah, blueberry hill, duh. Everybody knows what a blueberry hill is.
I was playing on the piano at Airbnb every morning. I have my sister stay with me from Germany for 2 weeks, and they're like on a different schedule. So every morning there's a piano at Airbnb. I found my thrill, and I would wake them up like that, you know, like every morning, you know. So I like drilled it into their heads.
Morning or 11 or 12?
11 or 12.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, but for them it's like, I don't know what time
it is. It's almost afternoon.
But. Yeah, pretty much.
I love it, man. Well, thanks for coming on. We appreciate it. Super short notice. I didn't know you were doing a gig last night, or else we would have been there. But sounds like it was successful without us.
Yeah, reach out to us. We'll come support you if you go out on Saturday.
Okay. Oh, and then Sunday. Do you guys know White Lotus Yacht?
The club.
The yacht owner is a subscriber of the channel.
Okay.
I got invited to play this Sunday, so I'm going to be playing there this Sunday.
Nice.
That's awesome.
I was with some guys that were on that last Sunday.
That's cool.
Felipe was not on it, to be clear.
I was not.
He had another guy. He knew some guys that knew some other guys that were on that.
I had another engagement, Bradley, and they left to go there, and I went to go there. All right. Is that okay with you?
I heard. Well, we'll be there Sunday. We'll see you on the yacht. And cool. Felipe knows the guys that know the guys, so he's going to get us on, and we'll see you Sunday on the White Lotus. How about that?
Sounds good.
All right. And then we'll run back the arm wrestling at another time.
Take her out and send her on a good drive. My heart is at 100, but I'm doing alright. Didn't know I would be losing a friend. I refuse to believe this is the end. I'm kinda lost in a city of angels. Such a shame that we ended as strangers. Million people watching, but I'm all alone. I'm waiting for your call, so I keep checking my phone. Silver waves and golden wings carry me away. Away, 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 away. Silver waves and golden wings carry me away. Away, 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 away. I have your favorite coffee on my kitchen counter. The password is the same on the Wi-Fi router. The key is hidden, same place under the mat. Let me know if you are coming back. I take a picture next to Hollywood sign. No matter who I'm with, you are on my mind. Looking for the green light in the busy traffic. I hear our song and now it sounds so tragic. Silver waves and golden wings carry me away. Away, 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 away. I take a walk on Santa Monica Pier. My heart is at 100 and I wish you were here. I'm listening to Freddie, how he's good at pretending. La La Land had a happier ending. Silver waves and golden wings carry me away.
Thank you.